He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
I'd like to welcome you all to our worship services Easter Sunday. It's really good to see so many of you out. And I wanted to share just a couple of announcements. If you were one of the people that signed up and donated flowers, reminder to pick those up at the end of the service today. If you forgot what you ordered, Teresa left a sign-up sheet on the back table, and you can refresh your memory doing that. The Worship and Music Committee asked me to make the announcement that when you're coming forward for communion, we're going to start with the people on the pulpit side and keeping the pew between each in order to do the social distancing. Then we'll switch to the lectern side. That way we kind of keep the social distancing thing happening. You'll notice that the words to the hymns are in the bulletin, and we are singing today. So keep your mask on and sing your little hearts out. So it's Easter, and how could we not? So there will be anointing made available during the concluding hymn. Same thing as with communion.
Yeah.
You know, as you come forward, keep some distance between each other. If you've never seen it done, I anoint and have a short prayer. Then you return to your pew in the most direct way possible. One announcement about an upcoming event. You'll notice both at the door as you're leaving and the door to the ramp, there are signs about Dr. Phil Carey coming here on the 18th to help us celebrate the 500th anniversary of Luther defending his work before the emperor. As I said, when I was in confirmation, the Diet of Worms, it's actually the Diet of Worms, but Dr. Carey is a world-renowned expert. He'll be with us all morning, and you're invited for that. If you're going to be here for lunch, we ask that you sign up so that we have the right number of meals. Then the last thing I wanted to touch on real quickly is none of this Lent, Holy Week, Easter happens magically. Many thanks to Teresa, who has prepared all of the bulletins and been heavily involved in the setup and takedown and changing investments and so forth. So we thank you very much. Michelle has been practicing to the point where yesterday her whole back and neck was locked up. And we thank you for the beautiful music. And Haley has been our little songbird for about a year and a half now since the whole COVID thing hit. And we're grateful to you for all your singing. There are many other people involved, but I wanted to highlight those three in front of you all for their conspicuously important and good work. So, once again, welcome. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. I invite you to stand and join with me in thanksgiving for baptism printed in your bulletin. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Refreshed by the resurrection life that we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rain to our thirsty earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life to be given. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Hallelujah.
Worthy is Christ, the Lamb of the slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and blessing and glory are theirs. This is the feast of victory for our God. Hallelujah. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation. Blessing and honor and glory and might be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. For the Lamb who was slain has begun his reign. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection you deliver us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection, through Jesus, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The first reading is from Acts. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testified about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name, the word of the Lord. We will read responsibly Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation.
The right hand of the Lord
is exalted. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord indeed punishes me sorely, but did not hand me over to death.
Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. Here the righteous may enter. The stone that the builders rejected had become the chief cornerstone.
For the Lord has done it. It is my
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians. Now I remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed to you as one of the first importance what I in turn have received, that Christ Jesus for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called by any apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me has not been in vain. For on the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Paschal Lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the 16th chapter. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Well, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We are remembering today the single greatest moment that has ever happened in creation. It is the day in which God's plan of reversing the fall hits its most significant and climactic moment. If you go all the way back to the very beginning of the Scriptures, they tell of the creation in the first chapter, and then as we move into the second chapter of Genesis, we hit a problem. The question is, if God made this good, in fact, very good, what happened? And what happened was a rebellion against the Creator. And for us as human beings, that specifically takes the shape of the story that's laid out about Adam and Eve, and how they were given some specific instructions, which they promptly disregarded. They were tempted to doubt the veracity of the Word of God, to doubt that He said what He said, meant what He meant, and that in fact, they didn't need God at all. They could go their own way and do their own thing. They picked Frank Sinatra to sing their national anthem, "Best of All, I Did It My Way," and the rest is history. So you might ask, well, how did that work out for him? There has been nothing in human history except duplicity, self-serving, backstabbing from the beginning until this very moment. Human beings going their own way without paying any attention to the loving guidance given to them by their Creator has made a royal mess of everything. Now, God's not surprised. You never catch him flat-footed, so to speak. God, from the very beginning, recognized that this was a possibility, but in order to achieve his desired ends, he created us in such a way that we have the ability to question him. We have the ability to choose not to listen to him, so that when we do choose to listen to him, that it means something. God is about relationships. He wants them. He wants quality relationships. And I gotta say, from my perspective, I feel a little bit like Frederick the Great, who said, "The more I know about humanity, the more I like my dog." God, however, likes us. In fact, he loves us. He wants to be in a real, genuine, give-and-take relationship with human beings. And so you start right there at the very beginning when we muck things up, and he's already working a plan that will not only overcome the brokenness, but in fact will gather all of the broken pieces, restore it, set it to rights, and launch a whole new era. And we call that, for lack of a better word, salvation history. And you begin to get hints and images and ideas that over the course of time, particularly through the people of Israel, reveal God's plan, and they keep pointing again and again and again to his choosing to come, take on our flesh, dwell among us, not only showing us how to live the godly life, but at Passover, probably in April of the year 30, going to Jerusalem, going to the cross, bearing the sins of the whole world, pulling all of the powers and principalities that are against God all into one place, engaging them, defeating them, judging them, carrying them to death and to hell, and leaving them there with Jesus bodily raising from the dead on the third day, as St. Paul points out, in accordance with the scriptures. And in his resurrection, he launches a whole new epoch of time. And here we stand. We are like Jürgen Moltmann's image of a human being at the shore, standing with one foot in the old way of things, the dry land of the beach, and one foot in the surf, the new way of doing things. And we're being invited to look over our shoulder and see this tsunami-sized wave of the kingdom of heaven breaking into time and space and changing everything. Through baptism, we are the people of the already arrived and not yet fully here kingdom of heaven. And in this life, we are given the Holy Spirit, we are given the fellowship of the church, and we are called to bear witness to what God has in store for all through Jesus of Nazareth. We are his witnesses. Now, in our day-to-day life, what's that mean? It means that I know a profound truth that affects every single thought I have, every choice I make, and I can either live the old way by the old rules and have the affirmation of people that are clueless, or I can choose to live in the light of Jesus of Nazareth and start living as if the resurrection's real, because it is. I can start living the reality that Jesus, in raising from the dead and giving his Holy Spirit and saying, as he did to Mary Magdalene at the tomb that first Easter, go tell them that I'm going to my Father and your Father. He makes you and me be his brothers and sisters. We're adopted. We are the children of the living God. We live in his kingdom. And the reality of who we are in Christ Jesus changes our options. I can now start thinking thoughts that flow from the resurrection, the new life in Christ, the new open-ended, wide-open possibilities of the resurrection, fully resourced by my Father in heaven for his glory, for the sake of creation, for the sake of my brothers and sisters, for the sake of the human race. I can live big. I have a son-in-law who is in the Green Berets, and he and his little group of friends have this saying about, if you're going to come out of the den in the morning, be a grizzly. Don't be a little Mox-Nix cub like we have here in Pennsylvania. If you're going to be a bear, be a big one. Be real. Live life large in the resurrection. That changes the equations of everything. I don't have to protect. I don't have to cover up. I don't have to live as if the pie is this dinky, tiny little thing, and if I let you have one crumb more for me, it's lost for me. I can live big. I can live like unlimited resources. I can live in the fullness of the resurrection, and I can start doing things like genuinely choosing the agape love that St. Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians 13, where I choose to treat my neighbor well, that I choose to construe their actions in the best light possible, that I choose to give them grace, that I choose to not be afraid, that I choose what's best. And I can live in that because the Holy Spirit's calling me to it and empowering me. And if I will let the Holy Spirit, what I see will be seen through the lens of the resurrection. My perception will be that of Jesus Christ. What I think about will be the thinking of Jesus Christ. What I choose to commit to, I can do it boldly and with courage because I know my Father in heaven will resource me. I can hang in there when it gets tough because God will never leave me or forsake me. I can see it through to a good end in the power of Jesus' resurrection. That's the kind of change that we're talking about. Now, truth, we live in this flesh. Luther was particularly good at pointing this out, that even though we're forgiven, we're still justified. He even had a cute little Latin phrase that you're going to need to know on the 18th. Simul just et precator. It means simultaneously I'm justified in the sight of God by Jesus Christ the judge because of what he did for me on the cross, what he gave me in the resurrection and in the Pentecost, and yet I'm still a sinner. I struggle with that dual reality while I'm standing here with one foot on the beach and one foot in the surf. But the kingdom is coming in its fullness. In fact, we'll be here soon. I can live as a child of the kingdom, in the power of the risen Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit, and that will affect how I deal with the people that live in the same building with me. My spouse, my children, in my case, my grandchildren, my neighbors, the people in my community. I can carry that different perspective with me to school and to work and into community activities that I engage in. I can choose to be a blessing to the world because of Christ Jesus risen from the dead and imparting his Spirit to me. We are really different. My pastor, when I was in college, was a ALC Lutheran named Conrad R. Walker. And he used to say that we are the walking wet. He gave thanks for our baptism this morning at the beginning of the service, because it's in baptism that we're buried with Christ and raised with Christ and given the Holy Spirit of Christ and sent into the world with a meaningful agenda to accomplish. Bear witness wherever you go, to whomever you come in contact with. Live the life of the resurrection and invite all and sundry to come to Jesus Christ so that they too can live. That's going to change everything. It's going to change you at home. It's going to change you in the neighborhood. It's going to change you when you step up to the ballot box. It's going to change you when you pull out your wallet and start putting money down on things. It's going to change you when you pull out your watch and look at it and say, it's going to be tight, but I have time for you. That's where the resurrection is going to hit. How you see, how you think, how you act, how you spend your time, how you spend your money. That's where the witnessing to Jesus Christ takes place in the world. He rose from the dead after going to the cross with all of your sins, all of my sins, and the ugly consequences of them. And in his rising, that's all left in the grave. And there's a whole new order happening in front of us. And he's saying to us, come on in, the water's fine. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
If I choose to stand with him, we get to sing.
Thank you.
friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism as we come before God to make public affirmation of our baptism into Christ. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you that you made us your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called us to yourself, enlightened us with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished us in the community of faith. Uphold us and all your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have bought to new life. We ask this in the name of Christ.
Amen.
I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the Church. Do you renounce the devil and all of the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant that God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God, and share in the Lord's Supper? May I borrow a different book?
Thank you.
To proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. People of God, do you promise to support and pray for one another in your life in Christ?
We do, and ask God to help us.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in your people the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Pray
Praise to you for the hope of the resurrection. Fill all in need with hope, those who are afraid or confused, those who are sick or suffering, those who are dying and those who grieve. Especially Randy, Terry, Kathy, George, John, Bill, Brenda, Linda, Sherry, Josh, Kyle, Rosalind, Tiffany, Corey, Brad, Angela, the call committee, Parker, Karen and family, Evelyn, Mark, Lynn, Ed, Danny, Mark, the U.S. Capitol Police and their families, and Janet. Assure them of your promises. Hear us, O God. Praise to you for the joy of your resurrection. Fill this assembly with joy as we are called your beloved in baptism. Multiply that joy so that we share it at home, at work, and in our community. Hear us, O God. Praise to you for your faithfulness revealed in the resurrection. Fill it with trust that we join with all who have gone before us in proclaiming your mercy endures forever. Hear us, O God.
In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all of the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection and his ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all those who share this heavenly food, the very body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy
come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The risen Christ invites us to this table. Come, eat, and be satisfied.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace.
Thank you. Beseeching our Lord Jesus to strengthen you with his presence, to drive upon you all sickness and body and spirit, and to give you benefit of life and peace, Lord, and you serve in all our lives. Patriots. Anoint you, Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Beseeching our Lord Jesus to strengthen you with his presence, to drive far from all sickness of body and spirit, and to give you the fruit of life, the peace and the life of the
For the rest of you, go in peace, serve the Lord. If you'd like, please stay for the postlude, and we'll keep praying for people as they come forward.
I anoint you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Beseeching our Lord.